Good afternoon. Can you hear me? Dear colleagues, dear guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed my great honor and pleasure to introduce the today's speaker of Mendel Lecture, Professor Kurt Wittrich. When I introduced Nenad Ban 3 weeks ago, I used to show the cover pages of papers which made it to the cover pages. If I should do the same for Kurt, then I'm afraid I would take too much of his time, and I'm pretty sure that Kurt will show you plenty of lovely pictures for those who love to see them. But of course, there is a number of people who like scientometric, and they would like to see some numbers. So basically, to introduce the Kurt, I selected only three of them. As you see, he published almost 800 papers, which have been cited almost 80,000 times, which is the average of 100 per paper, and his age index is incredible, 134. When I checked his CV, he obtained a number of awards, number of honorary degrees, but of course, above all of them, there is a one prize which stands, and this is a Nobel Prize, which he received in 2002 for chemistry. And the motivation reads, for his development of nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy for determining the three-dimensional structure of biological macromolecules. I think this says all. But of course, to introduce him, I would like to mention a few cornerstones of his career. He got a PhD at the University of Basel in 1964, and at the same time, surprisingly, he also got a degree in sports because he wanted to be a sports instructor. Then he spent a few years as a postdoc in the United States at the University of California in Berkeley, and then 2 years at Bell Telephone Laboratories as a member of technical staff. In 1969, his career started at the ETH, and it was a stellar career, and he went through all the stages, assistant and associate and full professor in 1980 of biophysics, and he became a chairman of biology department between 95 and 2000. Since 2001, he is associated with the Scripps Research Institute in a lovely, beautiful little town, La Jolla, north of San Diego. And he has been there since 2001 as a Cecil and Ida Green Professor of Structural Biology. But La Jolla is not the only place where he is still active. Of course, he's still active at EDH as a teacher. And he has offsprings in Brazil, in China, and in Korea. And with this, I would like to invite him on the stage. Kurt, welcome to Brno and to Mendel's Museum. Before you will get to your lecture, I would like to ask Lumir Krejci, who is a master of this Mendel lecture series, to handle you a small memory gift.
Now, oh, that's different. Okay. Very good. What was I? Where was I? At the beginning. Good. All right. You see, when I visited here in 1970, the main reason was to visit Tesla, who was manufacturing NMR instruments at the time. And I'm very pleased to see that NMR is really flying in Brno, and they have, I think, the best facility for NMR studies of biological macromolecules that is around, because it's all new. We others, we have old instruments, we are at a disadvantage, so I see a great future for structural biology here in Brno. I am going to talk to you about the post-genomic world of proteins. And I said colorful, so I'm going to show a lot of color pictures of proteins. That's easy for me. And the main point of the lecture is to show to you how advances in genomic research have really completely changed the outlook that we have. I mean, we meaning those who work with proteins. But this will come about halfway into my talk. Why should we be interested in proteins? Well, proteins do just about everything for us. They, I mean, our hair, there isn't much left, but I see a lot of hair here in the audience. Our skin, it's all protein. Enzymes help us to digest our food. Hormones regulate the enzymes. And then, of course, we need oxygen. And athletes need to be able to cheat with blood doping. And so we also need transport proteins. Otherwise, there is no blood doping, clearly. Now, when we consider that enzymes, hormones, and transport proteins have to be dissolved in water, I mean, all our body fluids are concentrated solutions of proteins. And consider that these proteins would also be soluble in water. We would have a problem. Clearly, especially in the climate as you have it here, and we have in Switzerland where it rains so often, to just wash the hair off our head. We cannot, based on the chemical structure of proteins, understand why the proteins in our hair and skin are fully resistant to being dissolved in water, whereas all these other proteins readily dissolve in water. It's not enough to know that the proteins consist of a linear chain of amino acid residues. We have to know the three-dimensional structure. Otherwise, no way to understand why hair and enzymes behave completely differently as proteins. And even among the structural proteins, there are huge differences. See, the hair can be pulled 2.5-fold. If you carefully apply pull on your hair, you can expand it 2.5-fold. On the other hand, you have proteins in tendons, for example, in the ligaments on the side of your knees. And if those could be expanded 2.5-fold, your knees would never hold, couldn't run. Or a cow, if the skin of a cow were made of the same protein as our hair, then the cow would sit on its belly and the legs would be sideways out because the cow couldn't hold the intestines. It needs collagen, which has a different three-dimensional structure. And so when we deal with the three-dimensional structures of protein, and that is why, because we could not otherwise understand how this class of compounds function. Now, there are different ways, and now come color pictures of proteins. Here you see just a line drawn through the alpha carbon atoms of a small protein which has a beta sheet structure. If we want to be more explicit in describing a structure, we would use this kind of schematic presentation with helices shown here and beta sheets here. If we want to be more complete, we show not only the backbone, but also the side chains, and then you don't recognize how the chain is folded. This is the same protein as this one in the same orientation. And we can also make a surface presentation simply by going from a presentation with zero volume for the individual atoms to realistic volumes assigned to each atom, and then we get this kind of presentation. Of course, all of this is important. We want to see through the protein. We want to see how it is folded, what the architecture is, but we also need to see the surface. For example, here we are looking at a complex of a drug molecule bound to the crevice on the surface of its receptor protein, and this is also a very important way to look at the protein, especially when we are into drug design. Structure determination of proteins and nucleic acids has been around for more than 60 years by X-ray crystallography and for about 30 years by NMR. And I understand that Nenad Ban was here a few weeks ago and he told you about crystallographic studies of proteins. Probably he talked mostly about electron microscopy combined with X-ray crystallography. The big difference between the two, which are still the key methods, about 99.99% of all structures in the data bank have been determined with either one of these two methods, that whereas you need crystals to study X-ray diffraction, NMR can work in solution, and since proteins in our body fluids are in aqueous solution, it is of some interest to be able to look at them directly in solution and in the future, without any doubt, also in the living cell. I used a few more color pictures to show you a comparison between information obtained in crystals and in solution. Here you have a simplified presentation of a small protein. The yellow line describes the crystal structure, and you have a group of brown lines. Actually, we usually use 20 lines to describe the NMR structure. Whenever the 20 lines superimpose tightly, as is the case here or here, then we conclude that we have a well-defined, precisely defined structure. When the 20 lines diverge, we realize that we have a poorly defined structure. And for the crystallography, the similar information is presented by the yellow circles, which indicate the so-called B factors, which give an indication of the uncertainty of the atom positions as determined by the crystallographic method. And you see that when we look at the polypeptide backbone, then we have a reasonably tight coincidence between the crystal data and the solution data, except that the increase in disorder, wherever it happens, is more pronounced in the solution structure. Now, when we go to other parts of the molecule, first the inside, then we see that for the side chains, we also have precise definition in the NMR structure. These are again bundles of 20 lines superimposed, and these lines superimpose identically with the crystal structure. So we can say that as long as we work with non-denaturing conditions in solution or in crystals, we have the same architecture for globulate proteins. As soon as we move to the surface of the proteins, then things become different, because now the whole entire surface of the protein is coupled with the water lattice. And the water is thermally agitated. We are at 300 degrees or thereabouts. And so we have coupling not with other parts of the protein, but we have coupling with the thermally agitated water bath. And therefore, we see a lot of disorder on the surface of the protein, whereas in crystals, the surface is equally well-defined as it is in the interior of the protein, because we have packing between the different molecules, protein molecules in the crystal. The next outer sphere is the hydration sphere. When we look at the hydration sphere in solution by NMR, we see a complete layer of water molecules on the surface of the protein. We can measure the lifetime of the waters in these hydration sites. And with few exceptions, the lifetime of surface hydration waters is shorter than 10 to the minus 10 seconds. You see, that gives you the direct answer why we have disorder on the protein surface. We have these constant collisions with thermally agitated water molecules. Then comes a next level of difference between crystallography and NMR, and this has to do with the fact that all proteins are not fully folded. This here is, it may be the first example that was discovered in this way. It is a so-called homeodomain. This is a protein that binds to the DNA and regulates differentiation in higher organisms. And by binding to the DNA, it initiates or stops the use of particular genetic information. Now, the preparations that were made of the homeodomain included 7 residues at the N-terminus and about 10 residues at the other end, which turned out to be disordered. You see here the bundle of 20 lines is largely dispersed, and so you don't get the crystal like this. The proteins which have fuzzy ends, they don't crystallize. And we know now by experience that whenever we have more than 6 disordered residues at either end, we will not usually get diffracting crystals. So we solved this structure long ago. As soon as the structure was out, the 2 ends could be cut off, and as a next result, 80 different X-ray structures were solved. Because when you cut off, the loose ends, then you immediately get high-quality crystals. And this is a game that we have played extensively over the last 15 years in my lab in the USA. And it is actually so that I bring this particular example up because this is where we usually beat crystallography in the game. I mean, a very typical example is the proteome of the SARS coronavirus, where crystallography solved almost no structures because the annotation of the viral genome was not very well understood 15 years ago, and so most of the domains had loose ends and didn't crystallize. And then, when here you now see a DNA complex of a homeodomain, and now one of the loose ends is structured here in the back. So you have here the major groove of the DNA, and here's its so-called recognition helix that's very well understood. And then you have one of these loose ends that reaches around into the minor groove and makes an important contribution to selective recognition of a particular site along the genomic DNA. Then there is more color pictures. Now we look through the DNA double helix, which is shown as a stick diagram, onto the homeodomain, which is shown as a space-filling model. And in between the two molecules, there are five water molecules, which mediate specific interactions between amino acid side chains and the DNA. And molecular dynamics simulations then showed that in a water bath with about 20,000 water molecules, all those that are colored yellow here would at some point be in the interface between the DNA and the homeodomain over a time frame of about, I think, 10 to the minus 8 seconds. So, and this again is information that would not come from crystallography. See, crystallography also determined homeodomain DNA complexes. And from crystallography, we know the locations in the interface where there is a high population of water molecules. But this is a static piece of information, and with NMR, we actually see the water molecules going in and out of the interface between the two molecules. And here I show you a corresponding structure. I mean, it's all about colors. I mean, I said the colorful protein universe, this is the structure of the core particle from chromatin determined by Richman's group in my institute in Zurich. Here you see the DNA, the DNA histone complex, and then here you have a picture which also shows the hydration of the core particle in the single crystals. Okay, so I hope to have given you an idea of why we study proteins, that we need to know about the three-dimensional structure if we want to understand how proteins function. And I showed you a number of colorful drawings, which in this case have all been made with a computer. Today we can make such drawings with computers. Now, since we are here in Brno, which has played and continues to play an important role with nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, let me briefly survey how NMR is used in structural biology. Formally, we got first de novo structure determination only in 1984. But this doesn't quite give the right picture, because we were working with NMR, making contributions to understanding proteins already in the 1960s. I use hemoglobin as an example, and I show you this picture, which really documents the start of structural biology. It's a picture of the Nobel laureates, 1962. You see here, let me see, this is Watson, Crick, and Wilkins, who got the prize for the DNA double helix, and John Kendrew and Max Perutz, who got it for protein crystallography, and Steinbeck got the literature prize. And here you see Max Perutz again holding a linear chain, a model of a chain of the hemoglobin subunit. And this is the structure for which Perutz got the Nobel Prize in 1962. It's a model of hemoglobin that was at about 4.8 angstrom resolution. And there were no computers who would make drawings of protein molecules in the 1960s. So they would use laminated wood platelets and paste those on top of each other. And so one could see the run of a helix. One could see the oxygen binding sites, the so-called heme groups. And in black and white, they used white and black coloring to distinguish between the alpha and beta chains, or the subunits of hemoglobin. Now, what Perutz saw, and that was a big thing in the 1960s, was that these subunits, that is, there are four pieces, four proteins aggregated, and when oxygen was bound, they rotated relative to each other, and Perutz could show that the distance between the two oxygen binding sites changed by 12 angstrom. And that was a fantastic result. It showed that upon binding of oxygen, the structure readjusted. What he couldn't, 12 angstrom is a lot, because the diameter of the protein is about 50 angstrom. So that's a huge change. But of course, you can't see any atoms in here. And so Perutz didn't see any change in conformation of the within the subunits. And so that gave rise to a particular model for the functioning of hemoglobin. It's an allosteric model, a two-state model, and so on. So that was a hand drawing from Scientific American. You see, there were no computers to make drawings of the protein molecules. So there was an artist, Irving Geis, who would produce hand paintings of the molecules based on the experimental data. This was very tedious work, obviously. And they also attached side chains here, which they couldn't really see. They were modeled into this. And so I took this picture once and identified groups here, the two yellow groups, which are very close to the heme group, and thought that if we now ran NMR spectra of these and added carbon monoxide and took it away, then we could see if they moved relative to the heme group. And so I had to use my own hemoglobin because nobody else wanted to have blood taken. And we didn't have a horse around at that time. And so you see, those who are in NMR, there were some lines outside of the usual region here, and then all the way down to the left. And all these lines come either from these two side chains or from the heme, and they moved around when oxygen or CO was bound. And so it was clear the model had to be changed. And there were also major rearrangements within the subunits of hemoglobin. You see, now you have another painting by Geiss of the hemoglobin molecule. And you had to include these changes if you really wanted to understand how hemoglobin functions. So you see, already in the 1960s, the two methods were complementary, provided complementary information, and they are still doing so today. I show you another example of the same time, very old work, cytochrome C. And now here, you can see the result of X-ray studies. Again, the laminated wood platelets, and here's the heme group in black. And that's what Irving Gase made out of this. So this is the experiment, and that's the artist. And that's how the structures were published. It took another 15 years until computers could make comparable drawings. I have several students who wrote software to be able to make surface paintings of proteins, for example. So in this particular case, we again have a heme group. And that has a consequence that the NMR spectrum, which usually goes from 0 to 10 parts per million, contained nicely resolved lines. But then the most of the lines were superimposed and couldn't be analyzed. So we played a lot with this particular protein, and in particular with amino acids that were bound here to the iron in the heme group. And when you look at this spectrum, then you see a methyl group here and four times a single proton, and that's a methionine side chain. And Dickerson, who solved the crystal structure, put lysine here. And he fortunately didn't believe in NMR and published this so many times that it is well documented that crystallography did it wrong and we did it right. And you see, that's how we started to get confidence in being able to do things. And the next step was to go in collaboration with Professor Ernst to develop two-dimensional NMR so that we could tear apart this part of the protein spectrum and see again resolved lines. You are now doing five-dimensional experiments here. We are doing seven-dimensional experiments. But usually three and four is enough. Okay, now I want to go back to very early times, a little bit before Mendel. There was a Mr. Brown, a botanist in England, and Mr. Brown played around with pollen. And in the spring, he would have lots of pollen, and then this pollen fell into a beaker with a liquid. And he took a microscope and looked at the pollen suspended in a liquid. And he noticed that the pollen were moving around. And smaller pollen would change direction more often than larger pollen. He published this, and it's known as the Brownian motion. And nobody understood what was going on until Einstein worked on it in 1905. And he worked on it in two steps. In Bern, he was an employee in the patent office in Bern, and must have been very bored with his job. And so his attention was drawn to Mr. Brown's publication from 1827. And he came up with statistical mechanics which showed why this behavior was observed. He understood that you had thermally agitated water molecules which collided with the surface of these particles. But the important idea was that this is a statistical process, so at any given moment, there are unequal numbers of hits on the left and the right, and top and bottom. And so when there were instantaneously some more hits from the left, the particle moves here, then comes a few hits extra here, and so on. And of course, a larger particle has larger inertia and changes direction less frequently. And that was published in 1905 in a German Zeitschrift für Physik. And then I suppose that Einstein must have been continued to be bored and started thinking about the fact that Mr. Brown could not have seen everything, because Mr. Brown could not see under the microscope when this particle rotated. And so he started to think about rotational Brownian motion. And in December 1905, he published another 40-page paper where he did statistical mechanics of the rotational Brownian motion. And that's the basis of just about everything we do in solution NMR. So when we now wanted to move from just picking little mistakes in crystal structures and adding a little bit to the information in crystal structures, we were faced with a problem that was put up our nose, that it wouldn't be possible to determine a three-dimensional structure of a protein if it rotated all the time. See, in crystals, the protein is held fixed, and you can take a picture. But if the thing moves around, I mean, when I say moving around, then these motions happen on a time scale of 10 to the minus 9 to 10 to the minus 11 seconds. So crystallographers such as Robert Huber would tell, forget it, there's no point to do this. That thing moves around and you can never make a picture of it. So it needed just another thought, namely that one had to identify parameters that would be rotation invariant. And a parameter that describes a three-dimensional structure and is rotation invariant is the distance between two atoms. The distance stays the same when the molecule rotates or translates. So if you could measure a sufficient number of atom-to-atom distances inside the particle that was subjected to Brownian motion, then you could determine a structure even so that molecule moves around and rotates. And so we found out that nuclear Overhauser effects would give exactly this information. We would get spectra like this, and with some mathematical treatment of this data, one would get a three-dimensional structure. All right, now I did my job with NMR, and I go back to proteins. Now I come to the point where genetics comes into studies of the proteome. See, structural biology developed very slowly during the first decades. By 1990, it had become a reasonable undertaking. See, in 1980, it would be typical that three students subsequently would work, each one for 4 years, in order to get a structure at the end. Or in NMR, we would work for several years at the beginning to determine the structure. So in 1990, Wayne Hendrickson and I started to publish an annual compendium of abstracts on newly published structures. And so in 1992, we would publish abstracts for all the structures published in 1991. And we did this for 10 years. And at the beginning, it was straightforward. You see, in 1990, we would get 130 structures or thereabout. They're always about 15% from NMR and 85% from crystallography. But in the previous years, up to 89, there were only 420 structures. And these were of less than 100 proteins, because many of these structures were repetitions from the same protein. I mean, 50 structures of hemoglobin, for example. But then you see how this went. In the mid-1990s, we were at 500 new structures. And in 1999, it was close to 1,000. So at this point, we had to give up and leave it to the electronic data banks. But still, there were only about 5,000 structures solved by the end of the last century. And today, it is more than 100,000. And the reason for this explosive growth, which started around here, was due to what we call structural genomics. And that's where our strategy used in structural biology and our outlook to protein research completely changed. And for this I repeat now, you know all this, but I think I still have to emphasize that we now have to think about nucleic acids as well. And we have what's called the central dogma of molecular biology, which says we have DNA replication, we have transcription, and we have translation. And the DNA chemical structure is also a linear chain. And when we now look at this information in the original drawing by Crick from 1957, who drew the central dogma in this way, that's the original drawing, self-replication of DNA, transcription, translation, then we have been in the position that we only had access to this until about 1997. We had no idea about the sequences up here. No access. So how did we choose the proteins that we studied? For example, we took hemoglobin because it is red and you can't lose it when you try to purify. The same with cytochrome C, it's red, so you didn't lose it. That's not trivial. When Perutz started to work with hemoglobin, there was no chromatography. You would readily lose the proteins. So you needed something that was plentiful and colored. And then you could work with it in the biochemistry lab and then in structural biology. Some other proteins were obvious, like the stomach enzymes, so they were studied next. Then there were proteins for which biochemists or medical doctors demonstrated that they had a role in diseases, and so one would add these to the proteins studied, not knowing at all how many proteins we had in our body. We knew that it was more than 10 or more than 100, but we couldn't tell whether it was 1,000 or 100,000 or even more. And so we essentially just played around. So by 1990, it became routine to express proteins recombinantly. And that, of course, opens the door to include new proteins that you could not isolate in sufficient quantities from natural sources. And that's why structural biology started to strive in the 1990s. But still, we didn't know exactly from what pool we were drawing when studying individual proteins. And so it's structural biology developed in the way that a given protein was studied, the structure was obtained, and then there were more and more details studied, ligand complexes and so on. But overall, the spectrum, for example, of target proteins for drug development was very limited. And now, by the late 1990s, complete genomes were sequenced. And all of a sudden, we knew how many proteins there were in an organism. We knew that E. coli had 4,000 proteins, or the SARS coronavirus had 28 proteins, or the human genome had 25,000 proteins. And now we didn't have to wait for red color or for a disease to happen. Now we could go to the DNA, annotate the DNA, and pick out particular genes and make the proteins from it and get structures without knowing anything else. These were no longer proteins that had been studied by biochemists. All of a sudden, we had thousands of protein structures with unknown function. This is a completely different outlook to the way we work with proteins. So let me go back to summarize what I have just said. When we get the DNA sequences, and that's true today and will be true forever, as far as we can see, maybe not, maybe some things will change, I'll come back to that. We have the genomic protein universe. We have DNA sequences that have been identified as pieces that encode for a protein. At that point, we don't know how the protein will behave. We don't know whether it will express. We don't know whether it will be soluble. We don't know whether it will crystallize. We have not that very much information. The hope has, of course, been that in the end, we would be able to predict from the DNA sequence what the structure of a protein would be. And that still is a long ways away. It's a disappointment, but that's the way it is. So we have to go to the proteome. We have to go to the genome, we pick genes, we put them, for example, into E. coli, then we get the amino acid sequence, we get post-translational modifications. If we work with cell cultures of higher organisms, we get the structures and we get the functions. So again, in a different picture, we have the genomic DNA sequences and we now add three-dimensional structures. But because we now get loads of three-dimensional structures that we can randomly look for, and we can also decide that we want to study something new. That means a sequence that has not been studied at all previously, we can start to talk about structural coverage of entire protein families. We can start to question how many different folds or topologies there are, how many different sequences can adopt the same fold. Can we determine function from structure and from this going to study diversity of metabolic pathways, so on, when we go from the genomic protein universe to the actual proteome. Now, this is not so easy. because it requires a very major input. I show you here a plot of the growth of the gene banks. So I'm always amused to look at it that way. In 1986-87, there were about 8,000 genes sequenced. And so the EMBL published 7 volumes which listed all the sequences that were known at this point. That corresponds to the books that Wayne and I published on the 3D structures. And just as we did, they ran out of steam with the books and had to go to computers, because the number of sequence genes first increased slowly. I mean, by 1995, it was about 200,000, and then it became dramatic. Then we had 10 million by 2001, and we had 100 million by 2010. Now, how did this come about? You see, we have only 25,000 genes from the human genome. We have another 25,000 from the mouse. Then there are about 1,000 bacterial genomes. Each one adds about 1,000 genes. But then there were guys like Craig Venter who took a boat and went out into the Pacific and collected microbes in the seawater. And with shotgun sequencing, he added 5 million. Then someone else took a sample of gut microbiota, I mean microbes in our gut. They added another 5 million. Then another guy had the idea of taking 1 kilogram of earth and sequence the microbes in the earth. That added another few million. And that's how this came about. See, and all this is a completely different world for a protein chemist now. See, there is also, when you talk about personalized medicine and base it on the 25,000 genes that you find in the human genome, and forget about the millions and millions of genes in the microbiota that live in our gut, in our mouth, and so on, it becomes a bit difficult to rationalize how one could get a good solution without looking at these microbes who live with us. You may or may not have heard about this new method of shit transfer, that they would empty a patient's gut, take, shit, from a healthy person and introduce this into the patient so that the microbes in his gut would recover with microbes from a healthy person. And this is now being used in thousands of patients. It's highly disgusting, but the medical doctors claim that, it's actually introduced orally. Yeah. And they didn't get away with the brownish color yet. And I have seen very disgusting demonstrations. But the medical doctors claim major results, positive results from this transplantation. You see, so much about personalized medicine based only on our own genome. I think I jump over this all. What I was going to talk about here was that we have built up a big structure. 80 scientists, theoreticians, biochemists, crystallographers, NMR persons, and in a high-throughput approach solve about 1,000 structures a year in our unit to help getting increased coverage of the genomic protein universe with three-dimensional structures. Well, I would like to end by describing to you an example of our current research where we again combine crystallography with NMR in, I think, a reasonably useful way. And this also is a story that describes the greatest success of the protein structure initiative in the US. The story is about GPCRs, G protein coupled receptors. And we have another consortium of about 40 scientists, which is directed by Ray Stevens. And within this consortium, I have an NMR team of just a few people, as indicated here. The story is the following. GPCRs are responsible for a wide variety of functions in our body. There are 828 certified GPCRs in our body. These are membrane-standing proteins, which are the targets for about 40% of all prescription drugs. See, GPCRs are responsible for many different things. I mean, for smell, for taste. They can adrenaline targets a GPCR. Heartbeat is largely regulated via GPCRs. Beta blockers target GPCRs, so on and so forth. So this has been a class of proteins which has been desperately investigated by pharmaceutical companies since the 1980s. And all of a sudden, in 2007, it became possible to solve a crystal structure of a GPCR. And now, 7 years later, we have 30 crystal structures of GPCRs. You see, this is an overview of those 800 GPCRs, and the circles each identify a crystal structure that has been solved. Now, how do GPCRs function? How do they look? GPCRs, this is a schematic drawing. That's not a crystal structure. It shows 7 transmembrane helices. All GPCRs have 7 transmembrane helices. The drugs are bound on the outside of the cell. This is a cell membrane, outside, inside. The drug binds here, and 30 angstroms away, the GPCR signals to partner proteins, G proteins, beta arrestins, possibly to kinases, that something is happening here. And depending on the chemical structure of the drug, different signals are transmitted to the partner proteins, which then start a cascade of follow-up reactions, cyclic AMP signaling, and so on and so forth. So the question is, how does this signaling happen from here through the membrane to here? And you can solve 200 crystal structures and they won't tell you how this happens. So what we did was to see crystal structures are done at minus 196 centigrade at liquid nitrogen temperature. And in crystals with extensive modification of the proteins to get them to crystallize. So we now started the following work. We would take the wild-type protein, introduce fluorine labels on the inner surface, and look at the effect of ligands of drugs with different efficacies on the signals of these fluorine groups. And I mean, this gives you the whole picture of this. We would here, you have the crystal structure of a particular one of these GPCRs. It's a beta 2 adrenaline receptor, adrenergic receptor, and we would have probes, fluorine probes here and here at the end of helix 6 and helix 7. This is now the actual crystal structure. And then we would take a group of, I think it's 10 different drugs going from inverse agonists to neutral antagonists to full agonists, and look at what happens. And now, in addition to having the structure from the crystallography, we could show that down here, where the signaling goes to the partner proteins, we had conformational equilibria. We would, for an inverse agonist, we would have a high population of an inactive form and a low population, that's in blue, the low population of the activated form. If we took a full agonist, I think isoproterenol, the full agonist, we would get increased population of the activated state. And in isoestrogene, which is the strongest agonist in this series, we would get almost full activation of the signal. And you see, this is a great way of combining crystallography with NMR. On the one hand, we need the architecture so that we can plan where to put our probes, and our probes can then tell us about conformational equilibria. And in addition, we would then get information on the kinetics of the exchange between inactive and active forms. And this, of course, then goes very soon into practice of drug development. Because if you have a drug which signals to, I mean, I'm now talking about signaling to G proteins and to beta arrestins. If we want a drug that signals to just one of these proteins, we may get a drug that has little side effects. If we have signaling through both channels, we have to count on having unwanted side effects. Say, if the beta arrestin pathway is the design pathway for the drug and we get strong activation on the G protein, we have to count on having undesired side effects and so on and so forth. Just to indicate what sort of consequences in applied sciences these findings may have. All right, I have talked long enough, I think, and I have shown a lot of colors of proteins, but most of all, I wanted to demonstrate to you that the continuation of Mendel's works in genetics, that's what really genomic research is, has also changed our outlook to protein science. And we get a lot of color and enjoy also the aesthetic side of the structures that come out. And I am sure that with setups that you now have here in Brno, we will see a lot of nice, colorful contributions from here to the studies of the proteome that we now know in the post-genomic era. Thank you.
Dear Kurt, thank you very much for exciting talk and for many colorful pictures. And I'm sure that we will have a number of questions either from the audience here or from campus. So who will be the first one? Don't disappoint me and don't disappoint Kurt. Yes, Lumiere.
Maybe I'll start with some questions so that the other people have time to think about. I was wondering, so how many new motifs there are in the structures of the protein? So do you recognize a certain structures, motifs that present throughout the different proteins, or there are still new motifs being discovered?
Well, as far as secondary structures go, it's always alpha helices and beta sheets and three or four different kinds of turns. As far as three-dimensional architecture goes, the number of new folds found has decreased dramatically. See, this protein structure initiative started, we would find a new fold almost every week. But now it is relatively rare. See, now we have 110,000 structures in the data bank, and it becomes less and less frequent. We still don't know how many distinct folds there will be in the end, but the estimate is maybe 3,000. And at this point, we have two-thirds of those.
Yes, Richard?
So Kurt, I wonder how much of the human proteome is structured and how much of what percentage is unstructured?
Have been determined. No. How?
Yeah, so what would be your estimate? How, you know, what percentage is being structured and rigid, and what percentage is flexible of human protein?
Well, look, I go to the next slide to give you a partial answer. I mean, your question really is, what percentage of the proteins in the human proteome have a defined three-dimensional structure? And how many are flexibly unfolded? Now, this is a prion protein, which is half and half. You see, it is 100 residues form three-dimensional fold, another 100 residues are disordered, are all over the place. But we don't know. That's what we found in solution. When this protein is present on the cell surface, it's very unlikely that it is really flexibly unstructured because it would immediately be digested by proteases that we know from experiments. So I think that many of the unfolded proteins are associated either with lipids, with carbohydrates, or with nucleic acids or other proteins, or most of the time in the body. I would assume that under physiological conditions, that's not just pH and salt and temperature, but that includes all the other proteins and the cell membrane and so on, that probably most or all of the proteins have a defined structure, just to protect them from being overly rapidly digested. That would be my guess.
Okay,
it's not knowledge, it's a guess, gut feeling.
Okay, now I will test our connection to the campus. Can you hear us, and do you have any question coming from the campus audience? So I don't know if the...
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Super. So maybe one question. Okay, just a second.
Okay, Karel, go ahead.
All right. So I wanted to ask, we were hearing the lecture about X-ray crystallography and NMR. But here at CEYTEC, they also built some cryo-electron microscopes. Do you think it is possible that the three methods will also get combined?
Thank you.
Well, cryo-EM is the upcoming method. And I think that at this point, there are a small number, a very small number of atomic resolution structures that have primarily been determined from EM data. Most approaches so far have used EM to picture to present large aggregates of multiple proteins and nucleic acids, but the detailed structures in these aggregates were taken from crystallography. That's as far as my information goes. I expect that electron microscopy, cryo-electron microscopy, will play an increasingly important role in the coming years. It is already playing an important role because we now go from studying individual molecules to aggregates of larger and larger aggregates, and cryo-EM will certainly play a very important role there.
Okay, the next question comes from here. I think Lukasz has a question.
So I stay with the methodological questions. NMR is still limited by the sensitivity. So what do you think? What would be the most important direction? Higher fields or polarization from electrons or better probes?
Well, it depends on what exactly you plan to do. I mean, you also have to consider money, right? So the most expensive way to improve instrumentation is to go to higher fields. That's extremely expensive. So when you use proton detection, then I do not think that higher fields are a profitable way of improving things. If you detect carbon, then you can go to much, much higher fields than today and benefit from the high field. I think that the sensitivity of preamps and things can be further improved. I don't think that we are at the end. So I see that there will be major advances in the design of the detector systems, and rather than going to higher fields. I think we have to clearly see that the potentialities of the method are not fully exploited these days, primarily because, and that's a contrast to the crystallography community, there are too few really top-notch molecular biologists and biochemists among the NMR people. You see, we have the methods of segmental labeling, for example. It's very little used. It's too expensive. In vitro expression is hardly used. It's very expensive. We are lacking funds to support the biochemistry that we need in order to make full use of the presently available NMR methodology. So I think there is a lot of development possible. I think that we will be able to determine, if not a number of de novo structures in cell, I think that within 10 years we will get key information on intermolecular interactions in living cells from NMR spectroscopy. So I see a lot of very promising applications for the next two decades.
Now I'm again asking, is there any question from the campus?
Yes, we have another one.
Can you hear us?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Good day. So my question is, if it's possible in future to solve the structures of some bigger proteins, because mostly NMR is quite limited in size of them, so mostly it's like 30-40 kilodaltons, is it possible to solve like bigger proteins with NMR in future?
Well, there are two parts to an answer to your question. One is that the physics problem of recording solution NMR spectra of large particles has been solved with experiments such as Strozzi and Krinept. We have presented spectra of particles as large as 900,000 molecular weight. And again, to make full use of these potentialities of the method, we would need more funds to develop biochemistry of sample preparation. But I don't see the limit at 40,000. I mean, the limit for de novo structure determination is somewhere in the 100,000 to 200,000 region. And when it's a matter of studying dynamics or conformational equilibria, I see that we are in position to work with particles up to about 1 million molecular weight.
Okay, thank you. Dan?
Okay, you touched. So you touched the topic of personalized medicine. And I wonder about the genome, it's a complex problem.
Well, what is your question? I mean, you asked me about the importance of functionally unstructured proteins.
Which is the basis for personalized.
Yeah. Now, well, let me give you an indirect answer, because I think I'm not knowledgeable to answer directly. What should we try to achieve with personalized medicine? I don't think it's realistic to think about developing treatments that are good for one person. I think that's a misnomer. What I think is that we should be able to do is to prevent incidences such as ones that have happened with several drugs during the last 10 years, that drugs were used, drugs for pain relief, for example, drugs that would be distributed widely in the population would be beneficial to millions of patients, and then you would have 3 or 4 deaths that would be traced to the use of this drug. And the drug would be taken off the market. The lawyers would come into this game. Overall, the company who was marketing the drug has huge losses. But more important, mankind has huge losses, because that drug cannot no longer be used and would be beneficial to most of the population. So we should be able to identify those individuals who would be susceptible to this drug, so that we could... You see, you cannot test the drug on millions of people. You test the drug on thousands, or maybe in extreme cases, 10,000s of individuals before it gets a go-ahead from the drug administration. And we should be able to prevent such accidents. I think that, you see, and then this, of course, goes, it doesn't need to be this. There are loads of people who are sensitive to negative side effects of drugs that are perfectly fine drugs for 98% of the population. And to find out about such overreactions to side effects from drugs, to eliminate those, that would be a great thing. That would be in the direction of personalized medicine that I think is realistic, but we are not there yet.
Okay, is there any other question? I don't see any more hands. Any question from campus?
We are fully satisfied. We are okay?
Okay, so no more questions. Please join me to thank Kurt again for exciting lecture.